Thank you, Bill. It's a great honor for me to be here this morning. I must thank Mike Sebastian for, first and foremost, for allowing Duanne Morris and Selvam to be a partner of the Golf Managers Association. It's for us, it's a privilege to be able to contribute and to support the association in any way that it can do. And I think that in the coming months, if we can show the way forward in terms of legal support, we would be happy to have done so, and you can be assured of our assistance going forward. Now, the topic I have today is on Myanmar. It's on everyone's mind. It's on everyone's lips. Myanmar, Burma as it was formerly known, is the hot new land, if you like, and people have called it the new dawn, the new beginning. There had been previously of if you like, the false dawn in the mid 90s. So this is my take on Myanmar. I'm also the managing partner of the office in Myanmar, so I've got some local intelligence. I hope that the next 20 minutes or so gives you a useful insight into what Myanmar offers. Well, the potential. I think it is without doubt that when one looks at the geographical location of Myanmar and the resources that it has on tap, and nothing but the word opportunity comes out, because every conceivable natural resource is actually located in Myanmar. It geographically, it is so well poised because it is shouldered, if you like, by China, India, Thailand, Laos, and it is also located geographically for the Andaman Sea on the left-hand side of it as well. So it has got a very deep port on the left-hand side, and you've also got the natural resources that it has been churning out over the years. Mining concessions for gold, for precious stones. You've got oil and gas mining concessions as well. Now, all of these natural resources have been unexploited for the last 60 years. And the opportunity there is for organizations to come in and help the country to tap these natural resources. Now, the government has recognized this, and as I think most of you know, in 2010, there were elections and a new government was formed. The first parliament, in fact, was set up. For the last 60-odd years, it was ruled by the military. And in 2010, parliament was formed, and you had the divestment of the powers from the military to, unfortunately, you still have a predominantly military rule because of the constitution, but the old historical regime of the generals have still carried forward, but with a democratic leader, very popular leader, Aung San Suu Kyi, as some of you may know. She has had her party come into power as well, having a minority stake. And so there is talk that that transition will continue to take place, and elections in 18 months' time may result in a sea change in the type of leadership Myanmar has. But underpinning all of this is the attitude that the current regime has taken, which is one very encouraging. It is encouraging foreign investment to come through. Now, if you are a cynic, you may take the view that this is perhaps the only way for the regime to monetize its assets, so to speak, because there has been a situation of a continual process of divestment and divestment of concessions and assets through through proxies of the regime. And the only way to realize and to monetize the full value of these assets would be if foreign investments come through. Now, that's a totally cynical view. The other view, long-held view, or popular view, is that typically when you have such regimes, they don't last more than a generation or a generation and a half. And if you count back from the 1950s to the end of 1950s to where we are now, we have more or less reached the end of that year, a one and a half generation, so to speak. So that leadership has changed, and so now there is a conscious push to open the economy, and therein lies the opportunities for the global market. I put in there the last bullet point. Naturally, if one is interested in investing or in exploring opportunities in Myanmar, it is also critical to have a good local partner to navigate the issues that that would face a party entering into Myanmar. Now, it's not all rosy. It is a country that has quite literally been frozen in time. In the late 50s, Burma or Myanmar was actually the richest country in Asia. So, but that country has not moved forward. So if one has had a chance to visit Burma or even to the capital in Yangon or Naypyidaw, you'd see that it looks very similar to some places in India, to Sri Lanka, or even Malaysia. Because some of the old colonial buildings look very similar. But underpinning all of that is the poor infrastructure. I think Jim also spoke about earlier in his presentation about the need for infrastructure in ASEAN generally. Well, if there's a country which needs infrastructural support, it is certainly Myanmar. The power shortages are quite frequent. You have once in a while blackouts, but brownouts are quite common because the grid has just not been set up to accommodate the upsurge and the buildup. The legal system is certainly progressing. The regime has taken a conscious effort to roll out regulations. Even as recently as 2 months ago, when they awarded the licenses for new telco operators, they didn't have the matching telecommunications regulations to roll out the infrastructure needed for the telecommunications industry. But that has been very quickly dealt with by getting support from neighboring countries in terms of what their legislation has looked like for those specific industries. So that's still in a state of progression, if you like, but it is being addressed. The Attorney General's Chambers in Myanmar works very closely with the Singapore government, with the Hong Kong government, with the Japanese government as well, in terms of rolling out legislation which they feel would serve them well. Political risks and uncertainty. I think it's strange. The last 6 months, we have seen we're experiencing a internal power struggle within the country. I think you have overtures being made by the Aung San Suu Kyi camp on she potentially running for presidency. And then you have, even within the existing regime, a couple of contenders putting their hats into the ring, so to speak. So that has created a slight power struggle and jostling of position for the upcoming elections in the next 15 months. But otherwise, there is no uncertainty in respect of the changes that are taking place. Primitive banking system, it is literally, it is primitive. Not many people have bank accounts. It is a privilege almost to have a bank account. People do walk around with bags of cash. Credit cards is not the norm. People rely on it is a cash economy, and you have and it doesn't help that the local currency, which is called a kyat, one US dollar is equivalent to about close to 860 kyat. So you can imagine that, you know, you have to go around with wads of cash. The weak educational system is something which is worth noting, because let me take, for example, the legal education or law. Law as a discipline of choice for students at university. It was at least in the last 15, 20 years, in fact, even a bit further than that, last 30 years, not a choice. Now you wonder why no one want to be a lawyer, but popular disciplines like law, medicine, and engineering were not as popular in those years, purely because the students did not see a future upon graduation. And for them, quite frankly, the future was literally getting onto the workforce and scrapping for a living, quite literally doing anything which comes their way. And so even for when we set up our law firm in Yangon, we struggled to find suitable talent, because it was almost like we have a twilight zone of talent, in that you have the really senior people in their 50s and 60s who can speak well and who have the qualifications, and then you have the currently very junior people and who are just literally coming out of law school, and in between you have a gap, and that's like the lost generation, at least from an educational standpoint. Corruption and cronyism, apparently, according to one of the indices, it's one of the most corrupt countries in the world. I think it does not necessarily reflect the nature of the people. It perhaps is a function of how the economy has run over the last 50 years, that corruption has become a way of life. I think I think those indices do not necessarily take into account how one would operate when you are running a cash economy. So notwithstanding that they are ranked very high in terms of in terms of corruption, they are still very genuine people to deal with. That's been my experience. Growing inflation, naturally you'll get that, and the lack of an educated workforce. As I mentioned earlier, the government has really pushed forward to introduce investment laws. They did that in a very big way in 2012, followed it up with regulations. But essentially the investment laws sets out in a set of principles, how investors are able to invest in Myanmar. I think what's useful to note about these recent developments would be the fact that the international community is also embracing Myanmar's development. I think the fact that Myanmar is hosting and is expected to run a fairly successful Southeast Asian Games at the end of this year in Naypyidaw is quite significant, because it is a major event for the country. It is meant to bring in a lot of tourists, a lot of foreign exchange into the country. But I think above all, it is meant to showcase the country's emergence from its frozen state, so to speak. You'll also notice that many neighboring countries and many countries around the world have been quick to wipe off its debt, which is owed by Myanmar. I think the general community, investment community, and the international community are realistic and pragmatic in the approach they take with a country like Myanmar, which is, let's be supportive of this country. It's going to emerge as a major economic force in years to come. Let's be supportive of it now and get in its good book, so to speak, rather than be hard-nosed and insisting on repayments of debts which were which have been historical and quite frankly not at any point will Myanmar be able to pay out its debt in the next few years, because it has got tremendous infrastructure requirements, and it is anything between 100 to 200 billion for the next 16 years. These are some of the laws that have been introduced. I think the most significant of it all would be the foreign ownership in restricted business activities. They tended to jealously guard and view with a lot of suspicion foreign investment in the past, which is not surprising for a government which was largely militarily ruled. In this instance, now they've realized that for a country to progress, they need to get foreign investments and more importantly, the expertise from foreigners. So they've allowed a scheme where in previously areas where there were restrictions of ownership up to 80%, but they've also quite cleverly required local partners to be involved, and that is just so as to give a prop up to the local investors, to the local citizens and the local companies. Areas of popular interest, mining, real estate, oil and gas. Whilst this is opening up more so recently, we should not forget the fact that countries like China, India, and Thailand actually have had a successful period of time in the mining and oil and gas sectors. They did it largely also through to barter trading as well with the government, mostly for military arms, for arms and other supplies during the period of time when Myanmar was an international outcast, so to speak. Those countries strategically took a place in engaging in trading trading activities with Myanmar. And it also helps that those countries are geographically well situated. The latest developments will once again give you a very good snapshot of how things have progressed over the last three odd years. As Jim mentioned earlier, ASEAN seems to be headed towards a significant milestone, particularly with the community being developed in 2015. next year is Myanmar's chairmanship of ASEAN. It's seen as a significant move and a very significant recognition by its neighbors of Myanmar's growing importance. And I think one significant point also to realize is the forecast that have been predicted for Myanmar in terms of the gas production, services and construction, the 6.8, I think that also reflects the fact that Myanmar is benefits from the level of expertise and the technology that is available right now for a country that is coming, that is really emerging from its latent state. Myanmar also benefits from the fact that it's going straight into the digital era. So whilst it has been frozen in time, it benefits from being in an environment where, quite frankly, you might have villages and townships in rural parts of Myanmar which would be equipped with LTE connectivity, as opposed to many parts of Asia where we still have 2G technology. Well, let me now summarize. The opportunities are there. There is certainly a keen intent by the government to embrace the international community. It has been evidenced by the type of laws that they have introduced. It is evidenced by the embracement of collaboration with other governments, and also on the ground, if you come and visit Yangon or any other cities in Myanmar, you will get a palpable sense of a buzz, as well as, you know, there is a cosmopolitan feel to it. Once again, it is developing in nature, and it is not necessarily for the faint-hearted, but therein lies the opportunity, because from my dealings with my clients, a lot of them want to know what is happening, and most of them want to have something on the ground in Myanmar, purely from an anticipation standpoint, they expect things to take off, but at the same time, they are a bit reluctant to go into Myanmar in a big way, just in case it turns out to be a false dawn. I think there is just far too much done this time round, which prevents it from being a false dawn. But that's my opinion, and I think if investors are looking to come into Myanmar, they should be looking to go full on and not take a simple let's dip our toes in and keep our options open, because if a concerted effort is made to invest into Myanmar at this stage, it will truly pay dividends in the coming years. Once again, finding the right partners is important. The local partners are inundated with opportunities. They are inundated with proposals. So it is not a situation of you trying to pick the right partner. I think it's quite a unique situation where the local partners need to be convinced that the investors coming in, you know, is someone whom they want to invest their time and effort with. And as I mentioned before, the local Myanmar people, my sense is, they're very trusting and they're very good natured, and you know, my dealings with them have mostly been positive, and I feel that in fact, anecdotes that I've heard from people who have been in Myanmar for decades support that view as well, which is quite frankly finding the right partner but investing time and effort in cultivating that relationship. But I think you cannot ignore the fact that a local partner is critical to whatever venture that one may undertake in Myanmar. Just so that I can put a golf spin into this, I've done some research, but I've not been able to verify it. But I understand that there are close to 127 golf courses in Myanmar. I suspect most of these golf courses were pre-1950s, although I think Jim's slide mentioned that there are most of the courses were in Japan. But anyway, the point being that as rich a country as Myanmar was in the 50s, you know, it is quite natural to have expected that there were many golf courses, but most of the golf courses are much older, and new courses are linked only to resorts that have been set up recently. I feel that the golf play, so to speak, in terms of investments would also be dependent on how well the country progresses and sets up the infrastructure. The very basic infrastructure, like the electricity grid, you know, power plants supporting that, roads, and you know, basic amenities coming through, not only in the cities but into the rural parts. So that's going to be that's going to impact the any potential investments. I would presume even for the golf industry. This is just a spiel about ourselves. We are Duanne Morris and Selvam are part of a global network of lawyers. So we've got about 800 lawyers worldwide. We've got most of our offices are in the US. We've got about 22 offices in the US. We've got an office in London, in Oman, a couple of offices in Vietnam. Our head office in Asia is in Singapore. We've opened up in Myanmar as well. We do a whole range of legal services, from advising on a contractual arrangement with between parties to listing companies on NASDAQ. We have been awarded recently multiple awards for our work in mergers and acquisitions, but we're also quite unique in that we have a sports law practice. We are very we have an acute understanding of sports law, and our practices in the U.S. Support the sports law practice as well. We have in Asia. We have represented organizations like Dentsu, the Olympics, small sports practices, and events organizers, all in the sports arena. And I think that we will be more than happy to, as a law firm, to support all the needs that the members have. In fact, if there's anything that I can do to help, not only on the Myanmar front or on the sports front, please do let me know. My credentials will be available by, I think, on the website and in any of these slides as well can be made available to all of you. Right. That's in Myanmar, which is Thank you very much.